Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and by other public television stations.
Although it is not expected that the vote on the proposed Panama Canal Treaty revisions will come to the floor until next spring, hearings begin this week, and of course the controversy has raged since a year ago. Governor Reagan elected to make it one of the pivotal points in his primary campaign against Gerald Ford. It is roughly correct, I think, to say that the majority of the American people at this point oppose the new treaty. B, that most conservatives tend to oppose it, and C, that most, though not all, American liberals tend to favor it. Conspicuous among the opponents of the treaty revisions is Mrs. Phyllis Schlafly. Mrs. Schlafly has appeared before on Firing Line in her role as the principal American figure in opposition to the Equal Rights Amendment. She appears, by the way, to be winning that particular engagement. There being few indications that the three necessary states needed to confirm are prepared to do so. But meanwhile, she has turned her copious energies to the question of the Panama Canal and will no doubt testify before the relevant committees of Congress. Mrs. Schlafly has a huge constituency from coast to coast, is often spoken of as a political candidate. She is a graduate of Washington University with an M.A. in political science from Harvard and is the author of seven books, the most recent, The Power of the Positive Woman. Under the glare of post-Watergate full disclosure morality, I am here constrained to perform a little arabesque. Arlington House is a publishing company owned by a parent company, which I serve as chairman of the board. They make the most of it. The examiner will be Miss Shana Alexander, about whom more in due course. I should like to begin by asking Mrs. Schlafly whether she would oppose this treaty if it happened that Douglas MacArthur was President of the United States and recommended its passage to the Senate.
Oh, I would oppose the treaty no matter who recommended it, because I think the terms are so humiliating to the United States and so adverse to our interests. I'd like to look for a few minutes at what money is involved in the Panama Canal Treaty. First of all, it involves our giving away our investment of $7 billion in the canal, paid for four times by the American taxpayers. Then it involves our turning over...
$7 billion, but what has that $7 billion yielded us?
It has yielded us the great Panama Canal. And the American people...
No, but what has it yielded us?
What has it yielded us?
Well, we know what it constructed.
It's a great international waterway.
No, but we have to pay when we go through it.
Well, but there are private people who go through. Certainly, people should pay when they go through.
No, my point is it's yielding us nothing.
Well, I want to tell you...
Do you know how much money we lost last year on it?
I want to tell you what
it's going...
$7.5 million. But let me tell you how much money it's going to cost us in the future, and that'll be a lot more than $7.5 million.
Oh, but are you through with the $7 billion figure?
Yeah, I'm through with the $7 billion, but that's just the start.
To say that you give away something that costs $7 billion is of no interest unless it yields you something. For instance,
yes. We
have more than $7 billion worth of installations in Laos, which we, quote, gave away, but they had no yield.
Yes, but let me tell you what it's going to cost in the future. I've made a list of the cash flow that is involved in giving, first of all, our capital asset, but also the money in the future. Now, here is what the Panama regime is going to get. By the terms of the treaty, they'll get cash, guaranteed cash of $10 million a year, plus another $10 million a year for so-called police and other utilities, for which they guarantee to do us nothing.
What do you mean, nothing?
Nothing. There's nothing in the treaty that establishes any level of performance for the $10 million that we promised to pay them for police, fire, street maintenance, and other utilities.
No, well, they must maintain order around the five military enclaves, which are ours to dispose of.
There's no guarantee in the treaty that they have to do anything for that 10 million. Then they get 30 cents a ton for going through the canal, which is estimated to be about 50 million a year. Then they get another $10 million a year if revenues permit, but which is cumulative and must be paid the next year if it isn't paid the last year.
If we make it.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Plus another $5 million a year for revenues and off of certain properties that are going to be transferred, making a total of approximately $85 million a year for 22 years.
Yes, but not from us.
It's
how much is that
going
to cost the American people?
Well, we don't know how much it's going
to
cost the American people.
I have an idea. The obviously, the 30 cents is paid by an Argentinian boat isn't going to cost us anything, right?
Well, we don't know.
Now,
but we guarantee.
We're also going to be relieved of the cumulative economic losses. Do you know what they are since 1913?
No, we're not.
Do you know how much we've lost in operating the canal?
Oh, we have operated it as an international waterway, in which
but
we
do you
haven't.
But we've lost.
We've lost money. We've lost a whole lot of money.
I know. So
that's nothing to the money we're going to lose in the future.
No, that money wouldn't. On the contrary, it seems to me quite plain that if we were to substitute the economic situation projected out over the next 40 years compared to the last 40 years, we're economically better off.
No, we're not. I mean, you keep interrupting me because I haven't finished with the cash going to Torino.
You don't mind if we discuss these
all
as
right.
we go along?
Well, let's come to the total, because in addition to that money that's guaranteed in the treaty, the State Department has also promised to give them money, which is loans guaranteed by the U.S. taxpayers. And that includes the $200 million from EXIM, from the Export-Import Bank, $75 million from the Agency for International Development, $20 million from the from OPEC, the Overseas Private Investment Corporation, and $50 million in military sales credits, making a total of $345 million in loans.
Yeah, but Ms. Schlafly, those loans are subject to the rules of the relevant lending agencies.
But it's guaranteed by the U.S. taxpayers.
But, well, it's our
direct pipeline in
our
the U.S.
participation
Treasury.
In the EXIM Bank is guaranteed by the American taxpayer.
Yes.
But the terms on which the governors of that bank make their loans require a schedule of repayments concerning which there has been a pretty good record
mm-hmm.
of performance.
And every couple of years they come back and ask for another appropriation to bail them out of their unpaid loans. Now, when you add all up this cash that's going to Torrijos over the next 22 years, it comes to $2.2 billion. Now, who's going to profit out of this? I think you have to ask the question, cui bono, who's going to profit? And I think the people who are going to profit are the American banks who have loaned money to Panama. And the latest Federal Reserve figures on American outstanding bank loans to Panama come to $2.9 billion. Those are uncollectible loans. Torrijos is bankrupt. He is right now today paying almost 40% of his national income in debt service. Now, you contrast that with the United States. We think we have a big debt, but we're only paying 7% of our national budget on debt service or interest on the outstanding debt. Torrijos is paying almost 40% in interest on loans he's already borrowed. Now, those are bad loans that are uncollectible.
Are you seriously suggesting that American bankers worried about their investments in Panama would begin to look after those investments by programming the relinquishment of American sovereignty in the area?
I certainly am, because these are the same banks.
Bankers may be dumb, but they can't be that dumb.
Oh, but look, these are the same banks who, when they had inside information that the New York City bonds and notes were going bad, unloaded their holdings on widows and small investors so that they could get out before the loans went bad. And these are the same banks who now see that their loans to Torrijos and Panama are absolutely uncollectible unless Torrijos gets access to those tolls and gets American taxpayers' money going into Panama.
What makes you think that Torrijos won't just renounce the debt? Why shouldn't he?
Well, he might renounce the debt, but
why doesn't he do that?
Well, he might. He renounced his own constitution.
Well, why does your situation alter it? If all he has to do is renounce the debt, then what on earth are all these figures? What's the meaning of all these figures? If he just stands up like Castro and says, I inform all Americans that all of the money I owe them is null and void,
He might do it.
Not going to do something about it. But we would be presumably in a better position to do something about it if we were still exercised de facto sovereignty over the area. And therefore, why aren't the bankers opposing this?
Because we exercised sovereignty over the canal zone, in no way does that give us the right to go into Torrijos's country, Panama, and take his money if he renounces a debt.
Well, it certainly would, in the sense that
we presumably would be
in a position to preempt for payment to prime creditors that income which normally would flow into the Panamanian government. This is one of the reasons
why
Castro has problems in facing recognition by the United States. We go ahead and pound his ships for the benefit of American creditors whose money he stole. Stealing American money is, as you know, an international pastime. Sometimes they call it nationalization, as in Venezuela, where they took 10 times the kind of paltry figures that you're speaking about. But I really do feel that the notion that that our entire diplomatic policy in Latin America is being written around a suggested bailing out of American banks.
Now, don't misrepresent what I said. I did not say our entire Latin American policy. The Canal Treaty is written around that because, as you said, overwhelming majority of the American people don't want the treaty.
How come they fool me?
Well, you have to explain your motives. I'm not going to sit here and presume to explain your motives.
Well, how come they fooled? Let me see. I wonder, can you think of any non-bankers who are in favor of this treaty?
Well, but what's important is not the non-bankers, bankers.
Is Bunker a banker?
Well, certainly Linowitz is a director and was a director and member of the executive committee of one of the principal banks that has lent uncollectible money to Torrijos.
Well, do you really think that Linowitz would devote his entire professional career to making good, even assuming that by your logic he would make good, a shaky loan to his bank?
Oh, but look, you were talking about the same New York banks that unloaded their holdings of New York bonds and notes onto unsuspecting little investors when, according to the SEC report, the banks knew they were going bad and they sold it to unsuspecting...
Well, why did they buy them?
Well, I guess they bought them because they thought
they
were good.
But
when
they
found out
they
were bad...
Why did they think they were good?
Well, which are you talking about, the New York
banks,
or the Panama?
The banks, New York banks. Why did they think they were good?
To Panama?
No, their own. Why did they buy New York securities?
When they bought them, they thought they were good.
Why did they think they were good?
Well, that's
I
their own mistake.
I ran for mayor 12 years ago and told everybody they were no good.
Well, all right, they made a mistake. But when they found out their mistake, they unloaded it onto unsuspecting investors.
No, that's
now,
really...
In the case of
a
Panama,
simplification of the
they
story,
loaned their money to Torrijos.
What happened was that Moody changed the credit rating from AAA to AA and then back and back and forth. And every time it changed its rating, there was a certain diffusion of funds because portfolios are not allowed to carry.
Mm-hmm. Well, all right, but regardless of what you say,
banks,
the notes did go bad and the small investors were left picking up the bill for the loss. And likewise in the matter of Panama, The big American banks loaned their money to Torrijos on the expectation canal treaty
the banks had huge reserves of city paper in 1975.
Mm-hmm.
Are you suggesting to me that they got rid of 100% of their holdings?
No, they got rid of about 60% of their holdings, according to the SEC report.
All right, they were left with a huge reserve.
That's only because they couldn't find enough widows to palm their securities
off
on. Well, that's what the SEC report said.
I mean, the SEC report said they couldn't find enough widows?
Well, they said they would have gotten rid of more if they could have found people to buy them.
Well, why did they not fall more in price in that case?
Well, they did fall pretty far.
But
let us get back to Panama.
To what?
Look, you're diverting the issue.
Who brought up banks?
I'm prepared to
discuss Panama Canal, and all of a sudden you're talking about banks who want to bail themselves out
by
alienating our only asset in the area.
All right, now look. The American banks have loaned $2.9 billion to Panama. That is an uncollectible figure. I don't think they have any security.
They're
promissory notes. Well, look, I've got the Wall Street Journal ad right here. They're called promissory notes right here. I don't think they have any security.
Backed by the credit of Panama.
Right. And what is Panama's credit today? It's zilch unless they get control of our canal.
No, so, that's not true.
Oh. When a country is paying 40% of its income on interest on loans it has already borrowed, that country is bankrupt. I don't think that can be denied.
The assets of Panama can hardly be the Panama Canal, since it doesn't own the Panama Canal.
That's right, it doesn't. But the bankers lent the money on the expectation that Torrijos would get the canal and access to the tolls. And I think this is the explanation
Why didn't they lend the money to somebody else and not have to worry about canals and things?
Well, that's a good question. But you know, there are a lot of banks today that are on the unreliable Federal Reserve list. So, I mean, we could go into another program on why they've lent money to the third world countries.
But you're suggesting that there was a compulsion to lend $2.9 billion
I didn't
to
say there
Panama.
Was a compulsion.
Well,
I said they did it.
Why did they lend it?
Look, all we need to know is that they did it. We don't need to know why they did it. They did it, and they're today sitting with uncollectible notes.
Well, they did it in anticipation of an economic situation.
They
now,
did it in anticipation of Torrijos getting the canal.
You're saying that they are motivated to crank up a national campaign. Oh, by the way, did the banks also engineer the riots in 1964?
No.
Did they engineer the 1967 mission of LBJ?
No, they hadn't lent the money then.
How do you account for those? How do you account for the fact that there is a historical sequence leading up to this new treaty that dates back to 1964, if you're saying that the banks were the critical catalysts?
The banks are the critical catalyst for this tremendous push to ratify this treaty today. Now, I did not say that they caused riots in 64. What happened to Panama then was that Nasser took over the Suez Canal and they started to lust after our canal in the same way.
Why is it... Why do you reason that as many American statesmen and congressmen as favor this treaty are dominated in their thinking by this tortuous concern for the $2.9 billion of some obscure banks with which Linowitz is associated?
Chase Manhattan, National City Bank, Midland, Bankers Trust, those are not obscure banks.
In that case,
banks,
let's call it an exiguous part of its portfolio.
They are very large and powerful banks.
Would you explain to me, take somebody like, Charles Percy. You know him, because after all, he's your senator.
Uh-huh.
Would you document the mechanism by which the Chase National Bank puts muscle on Charles Percy to come out in favor
of
a revised
canal
treaty?
Uh-uh, he hasn't come out in favor of it.
All right,
and I'm very hopeful that he will vote no.
Give me somebody who has.
Well, I'm really surprised that you're trying to argue from authority, Bill. Let's argue on the terms of the treaty and what it does, instead of
you started off by this crazy motivation, which really comes out of the fever
swamp.
Well,
don't you think there ought to be an investigation?
I don't care whether you can investigate all you want, but the notion that our foreign policy towards Panama has been dictated by these bankers strikes me as incoherent. We lost, as I said, 10 times that much money in Venezuela in the last few years.
So that does no excuse for losing more.
No, but why didn't we redirect our foreign policy towards Venezuela?
Well, there's something the matter with a lot of our foreign policy. Why have the banks loaned $30 billion to communist countries? Why have they loaned maybe $100 billion to third world countries? Banks are in real trouble
because
today.
They think they're going to make money. They're very stupid. I agree, but they think they're going to make money.
Okay. And they think they're going to make money out of the bones of Panama, and they will if the treaty goes through.
Why?
They will because Torrijos will have the cash to repay the loans that he has absolutely no possible way of getting from any other source. At the present time, Torrijos is getting $2 million plus from our annuity on the canal, and that will shoot up immediately to $85 million a year. Now, that's where the cash comes from that enables him to pay off the loans. And I think that this whole matter of I would call infectious invalidity. It's such a basic, fundamental infection that it contaminates the whole treaty. It makes it all suspect.
In the first place, there is no reason to suppose that Torrijos, being the kind of character he is, that he would use that money to pay off those loans.
Well, that's right. They can hope. That's their only hope. I mean, if you're a drowning man, the raft you grasp for might not hold you up.
Why don't we agree that although we haven't noticed it, every banker in the country has been conspiring all the relevant banks have been conspiring to crank up a campaign to turn America around on the Panama Canal issue. so that they can get their $2.9 million
back. Now listen, Bill, you keep setting up a straw man and misrepresenting what I said. There are lots of wonderful, fine, patriotic bankers all over this country. This involves only 10 of the most powerful banks.
And they're unpatriotic.
They are the ones who have loaned the money.
But they're unpatriotic.
I didn't say they were unpatriotic.
Well, but you say, surely it's unpatriotic to redesign American foreign
policy.
Well,
if you want to unload your bad loans onto the American taxpayers,
that's unpatriotic, isn't it?
Well, sure.
Okay, so there are X number of unpatriotic bankers who have this extraordinary leverage on public affairs, such that
after the Burt Lance case that bankers don't have extraordinary leverage, can you? Could you possibly be disputing that?
Well, they have extraordinary leverage over the mortgage in my house, but they have very little leverage that I know of on my views on foreign policy.
But they have a lot of leverage over President Carter's views and over and over Linowitz's views.
How do they exert that?
And over Henry Kissinger's views.
Well, I want you to...
And all those people have extraordinary leverage
over them. Would you explain to me the means by which these banks exert leverage on Mr. Carter?
Sure. David Rockefeller is the head of the Trilateral Commission that Carter is a member of. And presumably that is the banking community that is deeply involved in the loans to Panama. There are seven members of that commission in the Carter administration at cabinet level.
I should think in any trilateral commission that had as its members David Rockefeller and Carter, the guy who would be influenced would be Rockefeller, not Carter.
Oh?
I assume that the President of the United States is more powerful than the President of the Chase National Bank.
Well, most people don't.
Otherwise, why did he spend so much time trying to get my 15 cents as a deposit?
Most people think that the presidency would be a step down for David Rockefeller.
Well, why did he work so hard to get his brother elevated?
Oh, I'm not altogether sure that he did, but he certainly did work hard for Carter. And he brought Carter into the inner group several years before Carter became president. In any event, Chase Manhattan is one of the principal banks that has loaned money to Torrijos. And I think before we go any farther, we should have a complete investigation of what banks have loaned money to Torrijos, how much each has got riding on this treaty, and who's involved and who's got a conflict of interest.
Well, why is there, in as much as banks are not going to vote on this question when it comes up for a vote, what do we care if they do have a conflict of interest? It may very well be that there are some bankers around who say, I am in favor of this because Torrijos is a very nice guy and he's going to use this money to pay me back a loan, which is otherwise no good. The fact that such people exist is really, I think, a very minor consequence.
The reason the law...
Because we're talking about 100 senators, and unless you are here to allege that those senators are instruments of the banks, in which case you should have the courage to say so.
I don't say that.
It becomes absolutely irrelevant.
You keep misrepresenting what I say. But
I say, what is the relevance of all this bank crap unless there are senators who were dominated by these bankers?
Well, I think you can certainly show the conflict of Linowitz, who was the treaty negotiator. I mean, that's pretty clear. He didn't even dare risk a Senate confirmation before he went down there to negotiate the treaty.
What do you mean he didn't dare risk it?
He got a short-term appointment that didn't have to have Senate approval. And he was the principal negotiator on the Canal Treaty.
Have you heard senators rise up and assert his disqualification?
Certainly have.
Who?
Oh, certainly have.
Who?
When he went there to testify,
who?
Congressman Bob Dornan pointed out the conflict there, and he immediately said, I'm going to resign from Reed Midland Bank. But of course, what he should have resigned from was the Panama Canal negotiating team. Now, the treaty itself, let's get to the terms of the treaty itself.
So far you've mentioned not one senator who has disputed the qualifications of Linowitz.
Well, I mentioned a congressman.
All right, but not a single senator, and yet you're about, you go to an entire case on the assumption that 80% of the senators are going to vote because they tend to do what they're told to by the local banks.
I didn't build my case on that at all. In the first place, the local banks aren't involved in this at all. In the second place, I didn't say 80% of the senators were going to vote on anything because I think the Senate's going to reject it. But it is the terms of the treaty which are so disadvantageous. And I think that if we had lost a war to Torrijos and he had dictated the terms of surrender, that treaty couldn't be any more humiliating than it really is. Take the matter in the treaty that we are not even permitted to talk to another country about possibly building another canal. We're not even permitted to talk to them, much less build it. Could you justify that type of insulting invasion of our sovereignty written in the terms of that treaty?
Well, it doesn't seem to be insulting. It seems to be a part of a bargain. Torrijos wanted us out right away. We wanted to stay another 23 years. Torrijos said, well, if you stay another 23 years, that gives you plenty of time with modern technology to proceed to build a competing canal which would have the effect of having us wait around 23 years on a depreciating asset. We throw onto the table, very well, we promise that we won't compete during that 23 years.
Why should we promise not to compete? We don't owe him anything.
Well, we're trying to achieve something, right?
Well, what? But I mean, the burden is on the proof of anybody for the treaty to show why it's good for the United States, why the taxpayers should give away their tremendous assets.
We're trying to recognize that the same spirit that caused some of our forefathers to go to war against George Washington could presumably cause some Panamanians to go to war against us. Now, this doesn't mean that we can't win that war, but it is a war, it is the kind of war we don't want to fight, not only because wars tend to be unpleasant.
Look, if we don't give Torrijos that $50 million in military credits, he's not going to have any weapons to go to war against anybody.
Oh, the North Vietnamese didn't have any military weapons either.
Ah, but Russia
they collected them. That's right. Uh-huh. And why wouldn't they? Why wouldn't Russia send them
to Russia the may make some mistakes, but they're not that stupid. We've got completely...
Maybe the banks could send it to them. You know, those $2.9 billion worth of banks.
Jokes don't get rid of the tremendous
conflict of interest. The fact of the matter is that you don't need many weapons for terrorist warfare.
And we don't need many Marines either.
I have a feeling you're not anxious to pursue this point.
No, I'm very anxious to pursue it.
Well, then let me pursue it.
Okay.
One of the reasons that we want to revise the treaty is because we recognize that people, just because they are born in Panama, weren't born free of the same impulses that moved us in 1776 to ask for our own sovereignty. Now, I take the position that we are in a position to say no, juridically. We are in a position to say, look, we went there and we dug it and we fought our way through it and we went through all of the procedures necessary and we're not going to do it. All I'm saying is, I personally, owing no money to any bank that I can think of, am uninclined to that decision unless it is provable that that decision involves the security of the United States. In the absence of that proof, I'm very anxious for the Panamanians to share what sovereignty we fought for 200 years ago.
But your argument is based on the assumption that we are somehow interfering with their sovereignty. They have their country, and we have our canal zone that we bought and paid for four times, in which we have sovereignty, and in which every asset in it we built. And they have their country, and we are not interfering with their country. They have theirs, and we have the zone.
Look, there's no question about it. There's no question that the Dutch paid for Manhattan Island. But the fact of the matter is, at a certain point, the people who lived here said, look, Manhattan Island is going to be part of the United States of America. And if we've got to fight a lot of Dutchmen, a lot of Englishmen to do it, that's what we've got to prepare to do.
Well, now, then we ought to solve this question like the British solved Gibraltar. There's absolutely not nearly as much reason for us to give up our canal as there is for the British to give up to Gibraltar. Gibraltar is certainly part of Spain in a geographical way, and when it finally came to the issue, the British said, let's have a referendum and let the people decide. So they took a referendum. Now, we could have a referendum in the canal zone, and you know how it would come out. It would be about 99% to stay with the United States.
Wait a minute. The canal zone is the zone that the Panamanians wish to acquire.
That's right. They want to acquire it. They want to take it away from us.
They want to acquire it for reasons that I consider to be perfectly normal. You consider to be abnormal.
Well,
if there was a country that owned 100 miles east and west of the Mississippi River, and I would say it'd be perfectly natural for the contiguous states like yours in Illinois to say, we'd like to acquire this territory.
Yeah, but look, if they bought it and paid you well for it, and it was a source of tremendous income to your country, you'd be jolly well glad to have it. If we hadn't bought, nobody in the history of the world ever paid so much money for such worthless real estate as we paid in Panama. We bought that little bit of a 10-mile-wide strip, and it was nothing but a mosquito-infested, disease-ridden place.
That's right, and we got a lot, and we got a tremendous use out of it.
And the Panamanians are the luckiest people in the world.
Our whole investment in Panama comes to something less than the cost of 7 aircraft carriers. Now, 7 aircraft carriers, we're prepared to spend $7 billion on aircraft carriers, but we know perfectly well they'll be obsolete in 10 or 15, 20 years.
But the canal isn't obsolete.
Yes, it is. It is to a considerable extent obsolete because it's indefensible.
It is not.
All you need is one missile launched from a submarine to put it out of action.
Now, Bill, you know that's a phony argument. New York City is absolutely indefensible from a missile launched from a submarine. You know that in the SALT Treaty of 1972, we gave up our right to build any anti-missile defense, save only the one in Grand Forks, North Dakota, which we dispensed with under the Kennedy bill.
Which I opposed.
All right, it is a phony argument for you to say that the Panama Canal is subject to a missile attack. Because that is true of every city in the United States.
No, but that doesn't, that it means, it, look.
Every city in the United States is just as subject to a missile attack from a submarine Panama Canal.
If you're saying, can missiles land anywhere? The answer is that it is so obvious that they can that you shouldn't want to take my time to admit it. The point about the Panama Canal is, can we today guarantee that it will stay open? And the answer is no, we can't.
Well, Torrijos sure can't guarantee.
20 years ago, we could.
Well, Torrijos surely can't guarantee. In fact, in the Canal Treaty, he specifically refused to even promise that it would stay open.
I know he can't guarantee it, but there are two kinds of threats. Or to the closure of the canal. One is this missile I'm talking about, and nobody can guarantee it against that's happening unless we go back and build up an AVM system.
A second
is through espionage. And we can't guarantee the locks even against espionage, but we have a better chance of doing so if we have the friendly cooperation of an indigenous people than if we have none.
On the contrary, let me take the opposite of that. I think we've got a much better capability of defending the canal with the United States running it than we have with the way we are hamstrung under the terms of this treaty. Now, the terms of the treaty put the canal subject to the Panama Canal Commission, right away of which 4 members out of the 9 are Panamanians, totally subject to Panama control.
America.
Yes, but if we want to fire one, we have to get Panama to agree to it.
If
we want to appoint somebody different, we have
to
get somebody they appoint.
A president, we want to impeach a president. But the point is that the 4 people they nominate have to be okay by us.
Yeah, but they have to be okay by Panama. But we can't fire them without Panama's approval. That's in the treaty, too. All right. Then, in addition to that, they get to name.
And we have 5. They have 4
have
up
5.
Until 1990. Right.
Right. Then they have the deputy administrator right now.
Right.
And then after 13 years, they have the top administrator.
Right.
Then the whole thing is subject to a top coordinating committee that's going to give advice on which there is equal representation.
With us having to approve their people, and they don't have to approve our people. Go ahead.
Yeah, but it's equal. Then, in addition to that, we are forbidden to increase our level of troops. And the defense of the canal, while it says the U.S. is primarily responsible, nevertheless, the military board, which directs the policy and the planning, is composed of an equal number of U.S. and Panamanians who must, quote, act in concert, close quote. Now, I think that is the most unworkable. Even George Kennan admits this is an unworkable way to run the canal. We are totally hamstrung, and I think there's just no way that we can defend it.
You jumped a point here. What is unworkable about the treaty giving us the primary responsibility?
The fact that we are hamstrung with people under Panamanian control who have 4 out of 5 of the canal commission members right now.
Why does that hamstring us?
It just makes, you've got irreconcilable people.
The Supreme Court works that way.
Well, after 13 years, they'll have the top administrator.
Well, look, hell, why?
Oh, but
why,
look,
why
I'll
not go 23 years?
Court.
They'll have primary responsibility in. Talk about the situation in the year 2000, if you want.
Have total control.
You skit? Okay, let's talk about that.
Okay.
Let's not talk about
it. It's gone, yeah.
The treaty specifically gives us the primary authority and challenge to keep the canal open up until the year 2000. Then it gives it to them.
Right, it's gone.
It's gone. Now, what are we going to do with all... There's nothing in the treaty that says we have to sink our fleets or our airplanes. what use is the canal to anybody without our okaying access to it? Anytime we want to, we can keep anybody from using the canal. Just that simple.
How could we do that?
How? We use our navy.
Why, we guarantee that the agreement, that the treaty, that the canal access will be neutral. That means if we get in a war with somebody, if that had been the situation in World War II, German submarines and Japanese warships would have had free access to the canal.
You must be kidding.
Well, that's what it means.
The very first thing that the Germans did was close up their own canal during the war. They
had
the canal.
But
much more valuable, just as valuable as that, the Kiel Canal. They closed it right up during the war.
Sure, and we closed it.
You're suggesting that we would allow a Soviet submarines to get sort of a better fix on San Diego by using the canal?
As long as we control it, we would never do it. But when Panama controls it, Panama will do it, and it is specifically guaranteed that they will do it in the treaty terms.
Even under existing situations, we guarantee equal access to the canal. The fact of the matter is that treaties break down in wartime situations. I can't think of any treaty. We had a non-belligerent treaty with Germany at the time that we declared war. With Japan at the time of Pearl Harbor.
Listen, Bill, you're confusing the issue. After 1999, there's no more treaty. It's gone.
We have another treaty.
The neutrality treaty.
That's right.
And that specifically means that any warships can go through it on an equal basis. That is precisely what it means and precisely...
And what I'm telling you, Mr. Schlafly, is that if it were judged indispensable to security of the United States to prevent a warship from going through, we would prevent it from going through.
Oh, you mean we're going to violate the treaty?
Of course we violate the treaty.
Oh, you're going to sign a treaty now that in case of war, we'll just say openly, we will violate. Is that your position?
Wars transcend treaties.
Oh, then you think we should say...
I suppose you point to me one single treaty in the history of the world that has survived a war among contending treaty signers. Just name one.
Well, there are not very many, but certainly the United States got a better record.
There are none. You don't have... occasionally, you have these treaties about Red Cross and treatment of prisoners, and occasionally you find it mutually profitable to stand by treaties
like
that.
Okay, well, now let me understand your position. Your position is we sign the treaty in which we say that Panama will have the right to maintain absolute neutrality and let our enemy's warships use the canal after the year 1999, but that we frankly tell you that we're not going to honor that and we will close it on our own terms if we get in the war.
It seems to be so obvious that if we have a government in charge of policy in the United States, that would expedite the bombing of American cities by escorting them through the Panama Canal. We're going to lose that war anyway. The very first thing that you do is start sinking enemy shipping.
Uh-huh. Well, then why sign the treaty in the first place if you're very frank about saying you're not going to live up to it?
The reason was, no, we're living up to it under normal conditions. That's
but the treaty doesn't say anything about normal conditions.
They never do, Phyllis. Dear Phyllis,
Improve relations with anybody to say, we signed the treaty, but boys, if we get in a war, we really don't mean it. We won't pay any attention to it.
This is a grown-up world. You're talking to grown-up people.
Well, why sign it in the first place? You're
creating
false expectations.
You sign a treaty because a treaty is supposed to describe those conditions that obtain in normal circumstances.
Oh, no, lots of treaties go right through wars.
No, they don't. Not between contending powers. The only treaties, as I say, that tend to survive wars are those that have to do with the treatment of prisoners and so on. And those are very widely...
It was a good deal.
But you say, why do we want to do it? The reason we want to do it, I think, is because we Americans believe that the independence that we cherish is a universal value. And to the extent that we act hypocritically about this.
Who's hypocritical?
We are hypocritical if we hang on to a colonialist situation which is unwarranted by conditions of national
security. All right, now let's take this
question up. I'm just prepared to invade any country in the world you want to for the purpose of protecting America if you persuade me it's necessary.
All right, in the first place, as far as being hypocritical, I think the most hypocritical is to sign a treaty but say we're not going to abide by it if we get into
a
war.
Under certain circumstances, yeah.
All right, but in the second place, there is nothing about Panama, about the canal zone, that is colonial. We do not impose our culture and our regime on the Panamanians. They have their government and their dictator and their ways and so forth. For the second reason...
Well, it's colonial. It says we've got land
over
which we exercise de facto sovereignty.
Uh-huh. But we bought it. What's the matter with buying it?
Well,
the British didn't buy Gibraltar. No, they just took it.
We also bought Manhattan Island from the Indians and so on and so forth.
Yes, but in addition to that...
The fact of the matter is that we don't need that strip, that 10 miles.
But it's ours. It's absolutely ours.
We have a right to hang on to it. Uh-huh. We have a right to hang on to it is the correct way to say it.
Right. But yeah. It is not colonialism.
As if sovereign.
The idea of colonialism is that, in a sense, it was accused of being exploitative. There is nothing exploitative about our operation of the canal zone. We did not take anything out of the country in terms of natural resources. We put a tremendous asset in.
No.
And Panama's got cash-flowing benefits of about $250 million a year. We've made them the highest standard of living of any country in Central America. They're so lucky to have us there.
By the way, I thought you said they were broke.
But the government doesn't have the highest standard of living.
Well, they're broke.
Because the government has gone in debt.
We've got a high standard of living in this country.
Does
the government taxes people?
Well, nobody taxes
people. How can they have the highest standard of living and be so broke that they can't pay
off their poor banks? Other countries don't tax their people like the United States does. They just go into debt.
Well, you mean to say that Torrijos is afraid of taxing people? Good old communist rhetoric?
No.
Friend of Castro, Torrijos is afraid of... progressive income.
No, I don't know. He's not afraid of his people, but according to the New York Times, it's only the National Guard that keeps him in power.
Incidentally, I happen to be in favor of certain forms of colonialism, so it's not a boogie word as far as I'm concerned. What I am against is depriving people of something you don't have to deprive them of.
We are not depriving anybody of anything.
Oh, yes.
The Panamanians do not own one inch of ground in the canal zone.
Look, if you have a country the size of Connecticut, roughly, and 10 miles of it running from Bridgeport, Connecticut, up to Smith College, belongs to Monaco, there is a certain disequilibrium there that you tend to feel every time you're traveling from Stamford, Connecticut, to New Haven.
Yeah, but
You got to pass our soldiers, show cards, go over a bridge, not toot your horn, go follow the speed limit. They are having, when they traverse that country, they have to do what we tell them to.
Well, but look what they got for it. The first thing they got for selling us that crummy piece of land was their independence. They had revolted 50 times against Colombia, all unsuccessfully, until the 1903 treaty, in which United States guaranteed their independence.
That's right.
Then they got paid in cash very well. Then they got this wonderful asset. Then we went down there and we got rid of their malaria and their yellow fever and their rats carrying bubonic plague and made it from the worst disease-ridden country in the world into one of the most healthful.
Yeah,
they are so lucky that we are there, they should thank us every day of the world.
I couldn't agree with you more. But I'm not talking about historical gratitude. I'm simply talking about whether it's natural for people to want to increase their rights. Every now and then, we turn to the Constitution that we grew up with and say, here's a Constitution, for instance, that didn't grant the women the right to vote.
Oh, now what does that have to do with Panama?
And therefore we change it.
Sure.
Unquestionably, Panamanians' point of view of what they would settle for in 1903, it changes in 1973.
Yeah, but they had a good deal, and we believe that
women had a good deal even before they got the vote, but I don't think they wanted to vote.
If you want to talk about political and civil rights, you know that Panama has got the worst rating of any country in Latin America.
They don't have any political rights.
They don't have any.
But I would certainly not discourage them if they had a little revolution that brought on civil rights.
But under this agreement, we're going to give Torrijos the arms by which he will prevent a revolution.
$50 million
worth. No. $50 million in
military
sales.
What's he going to stick him in his cellar?
No, he's going to
use him among his people.
No, he's going to arm his National Guard.
I know.
That's exactly what he's for.
The National Guard. Look, there have been about 80 governments of Panama in the last 45
years.
Right. And there'll probably be 80 more next year.
And that's a wonderful argument for saying that the canal will not be kept open under Panamanian rule because it's the most unstable government in the world.
It'll be in their interest to keep it open.
Oh, but not necessarily. Not necessarily. They could hold us up. They could say, we're going to close it unless you do thus and so. In fact, I think the treaty would encourage them to come along.
How could they hurt us compared to what we could hurt them? Panama needs the income from the canal in a way that we don't need access to the canal. It would be an inconvenience, but not more than an inconvenience, for us either to ship around or simply to use one of our 17 railroads
to go across the continent.
Oh, well, it would be better even to just give it to them.
It would kill them.
But why are we giving them all this money in addition to the canal? We're paying them to take it. Well, sure, absolutely.
We will now hear from Miss Shane Alexander. Miss Alexander is a well-known author, writer, editor, formerly with McCall's Life, Newsweek, and so on, author of several best-selling books, Miss Alexander.
Well, I just want to get out of the way of this one. This is a marvelous debate. Let me just say what I think. I disagree with both of you. I think we don't own the canal. We have it as if sovereign. No Panamanian ever signed the treaty. It's so useless to us militarily that the Joint Chiefs of Staff don't want it, and the locks are too small for most shipping to go through it. Now, that's my position, which will never get said if I don't say it right at the beginning. And now I really think that Ms. Schlafly didn't get a chance to say, because you were so alive and exciting and marvelous, what do you want, as Dr. Freud once said? What would you like to have?
I want continued U.S. control and ownership of our canal so that it can be operated as an international waterway on the terms which we have proven over the last 75 years is fair to all and a very wonderful asset and available to us in time of military need.
And we want status quo, no change. Excuse
Absolutely.
We didn't allow Nazi shipping there during the war.
That's right.
Okay. So therefore it wasn't open throughout those 75 years.
That's right,
okay.
And because it is an asset of our national security, and we should be able to close it to our enemy in wartime.
So you didn't quite mean open to all, but you said it. Okay.
Well, that's right, and I certainly do think that's one of the major defects of the treaty is that we would not be able to close it to our enemy in time of a future war. And I'd also like to say in answer to Ms. Alexander that all of our Navy ships can go through the canal except only the 13 aircraft carriers, and that quite apart from the from the 1903 treaty, which incidentally was ratified by the Panamanian Parliament,
but it was signed by a Frenchman. It was never even signed
by a
Panamanian.
But weren't they lucky? Weren't they lucky?
Well, they don't seem to think so.
They did for 50 years. And we occupied that without any complaint from Panama for more than 50 years. And certainly that gives the title to you on the theory of adverse possession.
Well, I'm not sure that you're right about that, but you have a complaint from Mr. Buckley now. And Bill, what are you doing over on our side in this one?
No, I've always been on the side of human rights everywhere. What I insist is that there should be no historical abjection. For instance, I would never have used the arguments that you just used with Mr. Schlafly, because I think they're irrelevant. The fact that we took advantage of Buenos Aires was perfectly justified diplomacy. If we failed to be as robust in the future as we were in the past, we would lose whatever advantages to our national security we're in a position to. So I am not among those liberals who are apologetic about the history of our relationship.
No, but it's unusual to find you on this side in this issue, or so
in
it
which
seems,
issue?
On the Panama Canal issue, that you're in favor of the treaty.
Well, I gave the reasons for believing that we are net better off with this treaty than without it.
Well, you say you favor colonialism in some situations.
Sure.
Where
instance,
do you like
actually,
it these
I would
days?
Be grateful to any civilized power that conquered Uganda tomorrow, or Cambodia, and I should think that the anti-colonialist argument there would be frivolous to the point of depravity.
Yes, well, I would agree with you. I hate to get in the middle of this wonderful dogfight that was going on here.
You weren't dogfighting.
No, it was delicious. Yes, I don't know how to. I thought both of you being against the bankers was rather remarkable.
Well, I don't think there's any really good argument for turning over this tremendous asset and then paying him to take it. And after all, we have a tremendous investment in it. We think it's important to our national security and our economic prosperity. The overwhelming majority of the American people are admittedly opposed to the treaty.
Why?
There are so many
really?
Loopholes. I'll give you another loophole in the treaty. Did you know what's in there? That the American employees in the canal zone are going to be exempt from all income and other taxes. I think that's an unconstitutional aspect of the treaty. What right does our president have to sign a treaty with some other country exempting a certain class of people from the payment of income taxes?
Exactly. Say that again. Who's going to be exempt?
The Americans who live in Panama.
You mean who work for this commission?
Who work for the Panama Canal Commission, which is a U.S. agency.
They work for the UN.
No, it isn't as though it's a UN because it's specifically
it's
specified.
As though they're with the UN.
No, it
exempt.
Isn't. Well, they are exempt. Mm. But the Panama Canal Commission is a U.S. agency. And our president...
I thought it was a U.S. Panamanian agency.
No, it's a U.S. agency.
Yeah.
And there is, I think it's absolutely wrong to create a class. In fact, I don't think it's constitutional. That's just one of the unconstitutional aspects. To create a privileged class of people who are not subject to the same income taxes that you and I have to pay. And the other unconstitutional aspect is that the administration is not planning on submitting it to the House. Although the Constitution clearly says that Congress must has complete power over territories of the United States.
Yeah, I think you have a very interesting point there. But incidentally, I'm a little hung up on the other one because we have all kinds of laws that exempt all kinds of Americans. For instance, Americans living abroad don't have to pay an income tax on the first $20,000 of income earned from a foreign country.
They aren't earning this from a foreign country. They're earning it from the United States.
Okay, 25 years ago, the same law I just quoted said you didn't have to pay income on money on the first $25,000, even if it's from an American company.
Well, we're not discussing the rates. We're discussing a privileged class of people.
You're talking as though this were a constitutional first.
It is a constitutional first for the president to try to change
treaties
our
are
tax
the supreme
laws.
Law of the land.
Yes, but you can't change American...
Senator Bricker's amendment didn't pass.
Yeah, but we've since then had the Reid decision, which accomplished most of what the Bricker amendment would have done. And there's no way you can change our internal tax laws by means of the president signing a treaty with some foreign dictator.
If it's passed by the Senate, the answer is you can.
Our money bills originate in the House, you know, Bill.
No, but the incidence of taxes, only the House can raise money, but a treaty can rule over the taxability. For instance, an American who works for the Secretariat in the UN doesn't have to pay any taxes.
Yes, but he's working for a foreign international extraterritoriality position.
Yeah.
This is a federal agency. You don't think, for example, that the president could sign a treaty with France saying that our State Department employees in France don't have to pay income tax. Now, that's what they've done here.
If it was passed by the Senate, I think it could.
No, because tax laws have to be passed by both houses.
No, that's...
Under the Reid decision.
Laws that raise money have to be passed by both houses.
Well,
laws that raise
the tax laws have to be passed by both houses, but under the Reid decision...
Revenue laws.
That's a revenue. We're talking about revenue.
Bill, why do you think most Americans are against this treaty?
I know exactly why they're against this treaty. They're against this treaty because they see it as a pattern of surrender. They saw us give up on Vietnam. They saw us knuckle under to the Arab boycott. Mm-hmm. They saw us knuckle under to the United Nations on Taiwan. They see us now prepared to ditch Taiwan. They saw us at Helsinki, ratifying all of the conquests of the Soviet Union.
Are you in favor of knuckling under?
That's another good argument to be against.
No, but I think that these things ought to be viewed discreetly. Uh-huh. I predict that the treaty will pass or not pass with very little reference to its own merits. Its own merits, in my judgment, argue in favor of it. But if it is perceived by the American people as being a part of a general capitulation by the United States of its world responsibilities, then it'll fail.
Yeah.
And perhaps for that reason should.
Well, that's another good reason to be against it, because I certainly do think it is part of the pattern of surrender. Torrijos has made it very clear that he's a good friend of Castro. He took a retinue of 200 people over to Havana last year and proclaimed his solidarity with Castro. He now has just recently signed an economic pact with the Soviet Union to invite them in to build plants and do all sorts of things in Panama.
Yeah, because he can do that anyways, you know.
He can do that, but why do we want to give him a present?
But incidentally, I, for instance, am in favor of the Monroe Doctrine, which shows how reactionary I am.
Uh-huh.
I would have said no. He shouldn't have any right to invite the Soviet Union to occupy any considerable position.
But now you're going to reward him just after he did it,
We can't do better than the American people through their government, through their presidents. I founded a committee called the Committee for the Monroe Doctrine, mm-hmm. and we had all kinds of signatures, and nothing happened, as tends to be the case. The fact of the matter is that we have given up on the Monroe Doctrine, isn't it? Isn't that true? Otherwise, we wouldn't have permitted Castro.
That's right.
Soviet satellite mm-hmm. to lord it over Cuba.
But just because we gave up on Castro, which I agree with you on that, that is no reason to give the communists another base in the Caribbean.
No, but I don't think we're doing that.
Castro only allows a communist party to operate in Panama. He's a complete. Nobody elected him. He's just a dictator. He talks about his solidarity with other communists like Castro and that thug who runs Libya.
I doubt that you can say anything opposed to Torrijos that exceeds my own contempt for him, and I even know him.
Reward him?
Because I'm not rewarding him.
Why does John
Wayne? It is a plebiscite. I don't know. By the way, that's interesting.
Yes.
It is a plebiscite of the Panamanian people that is ratifying. Torrijos is uninteresting except he figured in the negotiations. The big riots in 1964 were pre-Torrijos.
The only relevant plebiscite would be the one in the canal zone. If you want to take one there and find out what they want, that might be relevant.
Oh, no, that's not relevant.
That's exactly what the British did in Gibraltar. Exactly what they did. And after the people voted to stay with the British, they kept it, and all the furor died down.
In the first place, it's not true, because in Gibraltar, the British have a right to buy property. Americans have no right to buy property.
Yeah, but they had no right to get it in the first place because they just stole it. Whereas we bought and paid generously for it four times.
No, I'm not saying that we didn't spend a lot of money. As I said, we spent as much as on 7 aircraft carriers. I think we got a very good run for it. But I think arms technology has made the old position obsolete, and that the position that comes to the forefront now is, ought we to behave like the same people who thought it worth risking a war to assert our own independence.
Oh, now, listen. United States Army, Navy, Air Force, and Marine Corps can't defend property.
They don't
against
want it,
that.
We can. No, but I say, should we?
Why, of
should
course.
It's in effect like saying George III should have won if he had been more powerful, but I think George Washington should have been won. Unfortunately, you can't answer that because we have no
time. That is not the same thing, because that was taxation of our people. We are not taxing the people of Panama. We
Thank
are a source
you,
of tremendous revenue to it.
Thank you, Ms. Alexander.
Thank you.
Printed bound transcript of this program, send $1 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250. That's Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250. This program was produced by SECA, which is solely responsible for its content. Funding was provided by this station and by other public television stations.